Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, everyone.
My name is Brandon McBurney. I'm a senior economics major, and I'm here representing SGA. When I had the opportunity to introduce this evening's speaker, I jumped for the opportunity. Today we live in a world where people are ignoring the issues at hand. They're ignoring them and convincing themselves that by ignoring them and not acknowledging them, they'll just disappear on their own. Tim Wise is not one of these people. He's one of the most prominent anti-racist writers and activists in the U.S. His newest book, Between Barack and a Hard Place, Challenging Racism, Privilege, and Denial in the Age of Obama, is just another way he had adapted to the ever-changing environment of racism here in America. He has traveled to over 48 states and over 400 colleges, and we're excited to have him here tonight at Villanova, so please give him a Villanova welcome to Mr. Tim Wise.
Actually, it's the microphone for the camera.
Oh, okay, so we do need it. Okay.
Breaking y'all's technology already. Okay, very good. Thank you. Sorry to be a few seconds late. I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you both this afternoon, and hopefully for some of you, you'll be able to make it this evening, either because you want more of this information or because you're being, you know, paid with extra credit to do it or whatever the case might be. Either way is cool. I do hope that you'll come. The presentations will not be, strictly speaking, the same. So there will be some overlap, you know, some similar thematic stuff, but a lot of different stuff as well. This particular talk I was asked to give, and really I'll talk for just a little bit and then really want to take some questions from you and have some dialogue with you before we get out of here in about an hour from now. I was asked to do for a very specific reason. Earlier I did a session with some faculty, staff, and administrative folks, and there were some real particular things that the organizers of my visit wanted me to cover with them. I did that. Some of that will also come up again in the talk this evening, and maybe a little bit here. They really wanted me to focus, however, with you all on this subject that we have this title that I'm sure you probably saw advertised for this session, or maybe you didn't, but the title was, you know, Some of My Best Friends Are Black, ... And the idea behind this presentation is one that I've given at many schools around the country over the last 15 years. Is premised on this idea, it's really not idea, but this thing that as an anti-racism activist and educator, I noticed really early on in the process of doing anti-racism work, even back when I was in college 20 years ago or more, but certainly since I got out and started doing this kind of work professionally. And that was the tendency for particularly those of us who were white, and your eyes do not deceive you, I am indeed melanin challenged in that way. That there was a tendency, and it was almost like you could set your watch by it. It was that prevalent, that whenever the issue of racism would be raised, whether it was by a person of color, surely, but even if it was raised by a white person like myself, that those who really did not want to have that conversation, and in fact, those who assumed they didn't need to have that conversation, would almost always retreat to this line or some version of it as a way to get out of the conversation. So they would say, well, I don't have to have this conversation. You know, I'm not racist because some of my best friends are black, or different versions of that. I dated an Asian woman once, so I can't be racist. Or I have a dream catcher in my rear view mirror, and so that means that I'm American Indian, and that my great-grandmother was a Cherokee princess. It means no such thing, right? But there was this tendency to try to get out of the conversation by way of making claims about your own personal stuff, and the fact that you have your stuff together so tight that therefore there is no larger issue that you need to be conversing about. Now, I used to be very cynical when people would say this. I am still somewhat cynical when people tell me, when white folks tell me how many black friends they have or how many Latino friends they have or whatever. And my usual response, when I used to be really cynical, and when I was younger and I could get away with this without seeming like a parent that was scolding their child, but I used to say, really, name them. You know, that would be my response, because I know all the names of my friends, oddly enough, first names and last names. I would say, really name them and give me their phone numbers and tell me their mama's name, because, you know, the thing about my friends is I actually know the names of their mothers, if they're really my friends, and almost never could people who told me how many black and brown friends they had ever do that. They might know the name of the person, who after all is an acquaintance of some sort, but when it came to like a phone number, give me an email, tell me their mama's name, where do they live, what's their address, you know, I don't know. That's not a friend. That may be an acquaintance. It may be that you want to be friends with that person. It's not that you're insincere about your desire to be a friend with that person when you say it, but it means that the odds are there's a little bit of a gap between your claim, you know, and the reality. I also was a bit cynical because I saw a poll several years ago. It was in the
mid-90s, so I realize it's a little bit dated now, but I doubt that it's all that different. In this poll, they found that 75% of white folks in the country said that they had many black friends. Now, I don't know about you, but I take language sort of seriously, right? So, and literally. Like, so when you tell me you have many of something, I'm trying to figure out in my head what that means, right? If you wanted to tell me that you had one black friend, which I can believe that. I can believe that a lot of white folks today have probably got one black friend. So if you tell me you wanted to have, tell me you had one, you'd say A, right? If you wanted to tell me you had two, which I might also believe, you would say a couple. If you wanted to tell me you had three, you would say what? A few. So see, when you say many, we're already at four or more, right? So what this means is that three out of four white folks, 75% of white Americans, basically claiming that we have four or more black friends. Now, I was a little confused. I'm not good at math. Like, you know, never was. So I didn't really know what that meant. I couldn't intuit that in my, but I went and got a census statistical abstracts of the United States, broke it out, looked at how many white folks there were in the country that year, multiplied that by 0.75, right, to figure out, well, what is that? And it turned out that that year it was 142 million white people. 142 million white people insisting to pollsters that they had four or more black friends each. Meanwhile, there are only 35 million black people to go around. And half of them say they don't have any white friends. So really, we didn't even have 35 million to play with. We had like 17 and a half million black folks that we might have been hanging out with to go around for 142 million white people. There is a math problem, right? It means either that we're not quite correct. We might think we're being honest. We're not lying necessarily deliberately. But it means that we're either incorrect about just how close we are to these folks, or, you know, possibly black folks are just really busy running from white person house to white person house to white person house to be our friends, which is really nice of y'all, but I think is probably not the truth, right? So that was what I would say when I was in my cynical era, and I got to get that out of the way because it's still part of me. But here's the bigger point. In addition to not really believing it when we say it, the larger issue that I want everybody to sort of internalize with this is that it isn't the point anyway, right? Even if white folks who say that they've got these close interpersonal relationships with people of color are telling the God's honest truth, and some clearly are, it really doesn't have anything to do with anything. And the people who have those close relationships with folks of color already know that, right? The folks who actually have those close relationships with people of color don't have to be told that that's insufficient. It's the people who don't really have that level of closeness who sometimes make a bigger deal of it than there is. Because see, what we do is we view racism as an interpersonal phenomenon when it's so much more than that. We view it as something that's between individuals. So if I'm cool with people, right, who happen to be from some different group than I'm from, then that means I don't have any bias. And that means that I've got nothing to work on. So that's fine. Let's think about the logic of that. Let me ask you a question. Are there any men in this country who are sexist? Are any of them heterosexual? How is that possible? You understand what I'm saying? Because by the logic of the person that says, well, if I got friends who are black, I can't be racist. Well, then if men date women or marry them, or simply are attracted to them, the fact that I'm a heterosexual man who likes, that means I can't be a sexist. So that means the only sexist would have to be gay men then. Does that even make the remotest bit of sense? Right? So the fact that you have close interpersonal connection to someone of a different group doesn't say anything about how you view members of that group generally. It doesn't even tell you how you view that person. Because there are plenty of men married to women who are pretty misogynistic and sexist toward women, including the one that's living in their house. Right? So this is not rocket science, right? Or as a member of the Tennessee legislature where I'm from, so I can make fun of Tennessee because I'm from there, you see. A member of the Tennessee legislature said a couple years ago about some bill, I can't remember what it was, said, you know, it isn't rocket surgery. Indeed, it's not. And the reason that I know this personal relationship piece, I'm not saying it's not important, because I do think that in the long run, if you're going to undo racism, if you're going to undo any kind of ism, you do have to have a relationship with people. I'm not trying to diminish the importance of that. I think for the long term, you have to have that. It's really difficult to maintain a commitment to undoing inequality or undoing mistreatment if you don't have that. I'm just saying that it's not sufficient
that you have that. And this is something that I learned, not just at some abstract level of statistics or, you know, funny humorous rhetoric and stuff that I say for a laugh, but like stuff that I know because it's my personal story, right? The fact of the matter is, I grew up in Nashville, Tennessee. I lived in the South all my life, lived in New Orleans for 10 years, grew up in Nashville, born in 1968. When I was 3 years old, I was enrolled in a preschool program at Tennessee State University, which some folks in this room will recognize as, but most will not, as an historically black college. Right? So it is a school where almost everyone there is black, and certainly the leadership of the school was black. It was an early childhood ed program. It was the preschool program. So I'm in the room with, you know, 20 other kids. All but two or three are black kids. I'm one of the few white kids. Almost all the teachers were black women. The administrators were black men and women. Right? All my friends were black. I was not a white kid that said I have some black friends. I mean, I had nothing but for like several years. That was my whole peer group, with a few exceptions growing up in those early years of school. So I would have been in a position where I could have made this claim, and I would have been telling the truth. Do you have black friends? Yes, I have several. Really? Yes. And I can name them? Yes. And I know their mama's names? Yes. And I know where they live, and I've been to their house? And yes. And it would have been true. But none of that would have mattered. And when I say it wouldn't have mattered, here's what I mean. After about 7 years of school, what do you think happened between myself and those folks in terms of the closeness of our friendships? How close do you think they remained by, let's say, ninth grade, eighth grade? Do you think that they drifted apart? You actually made that visual down here, which is the one that I had in my head, right? So there's this sort of parting. Now, it wasn't because I changed my feelings about them as individuals or as black folks. And it's not because they changed their opinion about me as an individual or as a white person. Right? We continued after that to play ball. I played on ball teams until about 11th grade with some of those same folks. But we just didn't have the same closeness. We weren't tight the way we had been. We were not really friends. We weren't hanging out. We'd see each other in school, and it would just sort of be like, hey, what's up? And then you just sort of move on, right? And nothing real close the way it had been. Now, if nothing really happened between us, it's not like we had a big falling out. It's not like they became bigoted toward white people or I became bigoted toward black folks. What was going on? Well, the thing that was going on was we were in schools together for 6, 7, 8, whatever, however many years, and those schools were treating us fundamentally differently. We were having a fundamentally different experience, even though we went to the same schools, right? And that experience was one where, starting in very first grade, and I can remember these stories very clearly, and even though I'm a lot older than most of you in this room, I mean, there are things like this happening right now in schools all across the country. Still, according to all the research, you have what? You have people of color who are being tracked low in the remedial and the standard level classes, not because they're any less capable, but because there are presumptions of their incapacity. And there are white folks like me. I was a lousy student. Lousy student, right? I tested well in the early years, but I was a goof off. I didn't get good grades. I didn't do my work. But I always stayed in that upper track. Always. Never got bumped from it. And the black kids who were really brilliant doing well in that lower track never got bumped up. Now, after 6 or 7 or 8 years of that unequal treatment, not overt racism even, it was sort of subtle. Right, for the most part. There were some exceptions. There was some blatant stuff too. But just the subtle stuff, the institutional daily grind of being treated differently, meant that after 7 or 8 years, we just didn't have a context anymore where we could relate to each other. Our experiences were so different that we just didn't have a lot to talk about, you know, other than like on the ball field or on the basketball court or whatever, right? That's about it. I mean, in the classroom, nothing, right? And then discipline issues, starting in first grade. Right, this sense that even though the white kids, I mean, I was one of the worst violators of like just everyday behavioral rules early on, but every time we would get punished, it would be differential. The level of punishment would be far harder for the folks of color than it was for myself or for other white folks. There have been 14 studies on this around the country, and they all have found the same thing, that black and Latino students in particular are like 2 to 3 times more likely than white students to be suspended or expelled. And it's not because they violate serious school rules more. That's the stereotype. That's the thing a lot of people believe. But it's not true. In fact, the rates of serious rule infractions are equal between racial groups and in some categories higher among white folks. White folks equally likely to bring a weapon or drugs to campus. Right? White folks more likely to smoke on campus. White folks more likely to drink on campus. White folks more likely to skip school and cut class, right? In other areas, they're equal. But this idea of greater disproportionate misbehavior is just not right. But teachers sometimes believe it is. Administrators sometimes believe it is. And the research says that teachers read the behavior different. So if I'm misbehaving and a black kid's misbehaving, the black kid's misbehavior is seen as threatening and more challenging, right, and more of an affront to authority than mine. There's an assumption that, well, we can just give the little white kid a slap on the wrist and send him home to his mom or dad, and it'll be corrected. But, you know, you'd send the black kid home to his family, and they just won't know what to do because, you know, their family lives are just in disarray, and they're pathological and dysfunctional. That's the stereotype. And a lot of times, that ends up creating differential treatment, right? So what does that mean? It means that after 7 or 8 years of school, we just weren't as tight as we could have been, right? And is another part of it. The fact that I had all those friends of color didn't keep me from knowing that, didn't allow me to know that, didn't keep me from ignoring the extent of unequal treatment. I didn't see all that I just mentioned to you until many years later. It's not like I saw that by 7th or 8th grade, right? I was sort of advanced in my understanding of this stuff, but it's not like in the 8th grade I said, oh, I understand why our friendships have been ripped asunder. It is because of the process of institutionalized white supremacy. I mean, I was pretty smart, but I wasn't that smart, right? It took me years. It was after I got out of college when I really sat and had to process that stuff that I began to realize what happened. But by that point, the friendships were already ripped apart, right? We'd already drifted apart, and I wasn't even thinking about it. Now, I cared for those young people that were my friends very, very much. They were the people that I had the most investment in, and I loved them dearly, but the reality is my love and affection and friendship didn't keep them from being mistreated, and it didn't keep me from receiving all those advantages either. And the fact that I figured it out 15 years later, you know, good for me, right? I got smart and I figured it out and people helped me figure it out. Doesn't change the fact that it happened. In fact, when I was in 5th grade, I had an overtly racist teacher at my school who didn't like the fact that my friends were all the black kids. I mean, older white woman had been teaching in the system for way too long, had been teaching in the system since the days of segregation, and didn't really like the fact that stuff had changed, right? And she took it out on black folks, but she also took it out on any white kids that hung out with black folks. And I was that kid, right? I was the kid in 1979 and 80. This is not to brag. This is actually a little bit embarrassing, but I'm just trying to be straight with you. I was the white kid who knew like all the words to the 14-minute version of Rapper's Delight. That was me, right? So I was the one. And no, I will not do it for you today, though I could, were I so inclined and had had a lot to drink or something. But I was the kid who would engage in these like absurd Nashville, Tennessee rap battles in 1980, right? I was that white kid, and this teacher hated me for it. Like, to her, that just marked me as like either a wannabe or as something, you know, whatever other terminology you might want to throw out there. And she took it out on me in terms of my grades. And so my mom came in to have a parent-teacher conference with her because she, you know, knew there was something wrong. I was getting like a D in reading, right? And I've been reading since I was like not even 3 years old. So my mom was like, okay, I think he can read. There's something wrong with the fact that he's getting a D in reading. And this was this woman's class. And she went in, and this teacher looked at her and said, you know, basically, any parent that would send their child to public, any white parent who would send their child to public schools after integration isn't fit to be a parent, right? Now my mom, to her credit, because she too, right, had closeness with black folks and understood the overt piece, went nuts, right? My mom went crazy when she said this, went and had her fired. Like the next day, she was gone, right? So on the one hand, good. Like that's what she should have done. That's the right thing to do. But see, then here's the deal. Basically, the next week, I go back to school. Miss Crownover's gone. She's not there anymore. We got rid of the bigot, right? But I'm still going back to a school that every day is putting me in those advanced classes. Every day, putting those black children in the remedial classes. Every day, treating them, that is to say the people of color, like exactly what Miss Crownover thought they all were in the first place. The fact that she's not there to dispense the negativity doesn't change the fact that the system was doing that. So the fact that I was their friend, it's not like I caught that piece. My mom and I caught the overt piece, and she stepped in, and I would have stepped in whenever it was overt like that, but the subtle stuff was still happening because racism is systemic. And unless we understand it as a systemic, as a system-wide institutional phenomena, we're not going to be able to get our head around it and our hands around it in order to really change it. It is about inequality of opportunity and inequality of condition. So you may have friends of color if you're white, but you're not going to be there when those folks of color are applying for jobs. And what does the evidence say? The evidence says that, for example, just as a few examples, job applicants with white-sounding names, they just think you're white. Don't even know yet. They just think you might be based on your name. You have a 50% greater chance of getting called back for an interview than applicants with black-sounding names, even when all the qualifications are the same. Same years of experience, same education, same everything except the difference in the name. In other words, merely being suspected of blackness gives you a leg down. Being suspected of whiteness gives you a leg up. You can have friends who were in that situation, but unless you're there,
to tell the employer, hey, by the way, don't treat my friend like the sum of their name. You need to give them, you're not going to be there for that. So that unequal treatment can happen even if you've got all those close connections, right? By the same token, you're not going to be there when they apply for a loan with a bank or with some other mortgage lender where the evidence says they're between 2 and 4 million cases. Now, I know that's a big spread, so we'll just, you know, for the sake of argument, take the lower end. We'll take the conservative estimate, 2 million cases of race-based housing discrimination every year against people of color. It's not folks of color that are just being totally unable to find a place to live necessarily, but it's folks of color who are being quoted higher interest rates, even though their credit histories are functionally the same, their collateral the same, their income, their occupational status the same. Now, when you get quoted a higher interest rate, you get a 30-year loan over the course of 30 years, you might pay $200,000, $250,000 extra. $250,000 extra in payments that you'll have to make to the bank over the course of that loan. Now, that black person or Latino who has to do that may have white friends. But unless their white friends are there every time they try to get a loan, to say, now, hold on a minute, don't treat them the way that the stereotype says, they're my buddy. You know, you got to treat them right because I love them. Oh, okay, well, now that I know, you know, fine, here, 5%. You know, I was going to give you 7, and then white dude said he was your friend. So here, you know, have a better deal. That's not going to happen. So you have people who are suffering inequity of treatment having nothing to do with their personal relationships and connections to people who happen to be, in this case, white. Similarly, you're not necessarily going to be there when your friend of color, assuming that they exist, right, and not trying to minimize the value of that, assuming that they exist, you're not going to be there when they get pulled over by a police officer on suspicion of doing something they did not do. And yet we know what the data says because the Justice Department tells us. Now, I say we know, but we don't really know because the media doesn't talk about this very much. So back in 2004, for example, the Department of Justice released a report which said that black and Latino males, 2 to 3 times, more likely than white males, to be stopped and have their cars and their physical bodies searched by police when they're looking for drugs or other contraband. Even though white men, on the occasions when we are searched, which is half as often or one-third as often, right? On the occasions when we're searched, we're actually 4 times more likely to have the stuff on us, according to the research. So white folks, 4 times more likely to be guilty on the occasions when we finally get searched, but we're only 1/3 as likely or 1/2 as likely to be searched in the first place. Now, see, that's a problem, right? Because it tells you that the war on drugs is not about drugs, right? And that racial profiling is not about finding drugs. It's not about actually stopping illegality. If you're going to fight a war, whether it's on drugs or on terrorism, in theory, you're supposed to go where the enemy is. I know we have a problem with that, right? We have a problem with that as a country as of late. But that's the theory, you're supposed to do that. And yet the data says that's not what law enforcement does. And the fact that I've got black friends, unless I'm right there in the car with them, and I pop out of the trunk when the cop pops it looking for heroin, right? Here I am, and that's my friend. Don't search the wheel well. There's no reason to search the wheel well unless I'm right there, like, you know, under the seat or driving behind them, like in a car, watching them. You know, I mean, it doesn't matter that they're my friends in terms of actually stopping the unfair and unequal treatment to which they may likely be subjected. And none of this stuff that I'm talking about here, whether we're talking about the job market or criminal justice system or housing or healthcare, I should point out, because there are about 100 studies in the last decade which have found 2 very important things, neither of which got mentioned in the healthcare debate, right? Which I think is really instructive that they didn't get mentioned. Because if you listen to the healthcare debate, you would think that it was just about coverage. It was just about affordability. So if we can just make sure it's affordable for everyone, everything will be fine. But what the 100 studies have found is that the biggest disparities between white folks and black folks, for example, are not at the issue of, not related to the issue of whether you have coverage, right? It's not about economics. It's not about the financial end of it. Now, I'm not saying that's not important, but that's not where the racial gaps manifest. The racial gaps actually manifest at the top of the income spectrum, right? The biggest gaps are between white and black folks, all of whom have good jobs and decent health care and pretty good incomes, because the white folks at that level almost inevitably have, on balance, really good health, and people of color, lousy health, right? Black women who have college degrees, good jobs, good incomes, and health care actually have higher rates of infant mortality for their children, for their newborns, than white women who dropped out after the 8th grade. Right, and who are poor and don't have good health care. Right? We have, you know, evidence that the cumulative effect of racial discrimination on people of color over many years is having health consequences in terms of blood pressure, in terms of the release of stress hormones, right, in terms of what physicians call the allostatic load, right? This is a big sort of fancy terminology, but allostasis is this concept that the body returns to normal after periods of stress. It's the ability of the body to adapt to stressful situations and then sort of return to balance. And what the evidence says is that for folks of color, there's so much allostatic load, so much loading of these stress factors that you can't return to normal. So you have black folks going to sleep at night being monitored, and their blood pressure is not dropping at night,
right? Which is what, for white folks, it does. Like, white folks go to bed at night, and for the most part, your blood pressure drops, even low-income white folks. Black and brown folks who are not poor, right? Whose lifestyles are fundamentally the same, whose diets are fundamentally the same. As white folks are going to bed, their blood pressure is not dropping. It's like there's something happening, right? And the research says it's about racial inequity. The fact that some of those black folks have got white friends doesn't stop that. Right? The fact that I've got some black friends, I'm not there with them to like wake them up and tell them, relax, right? Relax, it's okay, really. Let your blood pressure drop. That doesn't work that way, right? And the other studies have found that doctors are often receiving unequal treatment. I mean, excuse me, doctors are often providing unequal treatment to patients. They're not doing it on purpose. Right? Most doctors are not, you know, racist in that traditional sense of the word, or bigots. Most doctors are caring professionals who want to make sure all their patients live and are healthy. That's your incentive when you're a doctor. You want to do right by your patients. But doctors are subjected to the same stereotypes that we're all subjected to. Right? They internalize the same things. They see the same media imagery. They have the same impressions. So they've done studies with medical school students where they take them and they sit them in a sort of an experimental setting and they show them videos of people who they think are real patients, right? But really they're actors. And they basically are describing the same symptoms. One of the actors is black, one of the actors is white. They show them separately, right? And then they're describing the same symptoms. They have the same insurance coverage. They have the same occupational status, right? They, in every way, they're really indistinguishable except for race. Their communication styles are the same, right? And yet when they're done, they end up getting very different prognosis, diagnosis, and intervention recommended, right? The white patients, the doctors give much more sort of immediate intervention, much more dramatic sort of hardcore intervention to save their lives. They take the illness more seriously, even though it's the same illness being described. At the end, they do a post-study interview where they ask the medical school students about their perceptions of the quote-unquote patients, right, who they believe to have been real. And they say things like, you know, that they perceive the black patient as not being as smart, not likely to follow a treatment recommendation, not likely to make appointments on time, not likely to take their medicines regularly, right? Is that about overt bigotry? No, but it's about this internalized bias, this presumption about, you know, who's sort of better in some sense and who's worse. And so even doctors who are good caring professionals do that. The fact that some of those doctors probably have black friends, right, if they're white. Some of them probably have Latino friends. They may be married to a person of color, and yet, right, those stereotypes can still exist. And none of that ended just because the president of the United States is a man of color. Right, which is something we need to also get our heads around, because a lot of times people say, yes, I understand this is all true sort of historically, and this has been an issue. Only a fool would deny that. But a lot of those same people will say, well, yeah, but pretty soon that'll all be over with if it's not already, because the president is Barack Obama. And so since he's a man of color, surely we'll get over this stuff. And then young people, college students will say, oh, well, you know, this is like y'all's problem, meaning people my age and older. Right? This is 40 and 50 and 60 and 70-year-old people's problem. This is not our problem. We sort of don't see color and we don't think about it. But now here's the thing, right? Before I talk about the inadequacy of Obama in that sense. There was a study done recently by two sociologists, one at Texas A&M, the other at the University of Toledo or Dayton, one or the other, did a book called Two-Faced Racism, Leslie Picka and Joe Fagan. And what Fagan and Picka did was they were curious about young people, and college students in particular, and the degree to which racism manifests among younger people. Because so often younger folks are like, oh, it's not us, that's y'all, it's not our problem. So what they did is they had 676, or 626, I guess, white students at two dozen colleges around the country, some private, some public, all around the country, right, keep journals for 6 weeks where they were asked, during the course of that 6 weeks, these white students, that their only job was they had to write down and chronicle in the journal every time that they were in the presence of other white people who told a racist joke, who made a racist comment, or who acted out in some racist way vis-a-vis people of color. Anything that could be interpreted as sort of a racist performance or act of some sort. Right? And so they did this for 6 weeks. 626 white students keeping these journals. At the end, they collected the journals. When they looked through the journals, there were 9,500 incidents that had been chronicled by these 626 students over a six-week period. Now, Fagan and Picka, trying to be fair, excluded 2,000 of those from consideration because when they looked through them, they were a little vague. They were things that sort of borderline, like, you know, not a clear call. So if it wasn't clear, they excluded it. They wanted to have the lowest possible estimate. They only left the 7,500 cases that were blatant, right, that were just obvious that this is racism, straight up. 7,500 cases in 12 weeks, 626 students, basically two a week, per student, per week, throughout the course of the overall, is 12 incidents per person, or two a week. And then you multiply that, if you think about this is randomly selected students at colleges. Think about what this would mean if you multiplied this throughout the country. right? If we're really seeing that kind, if we're hearing that kind of racist or racially prejudicial behavior, how can we believe that's not having an effect on us? And how can we say, oh, it's not us, it's not our problem, this generation has it all figured out? See, we have some things figured out better than we do, and we had some things figured out better than our parents, but there's quite a bit of ways to go. As far as President Obama, the idea that somehow his election would erase any of this or make this go away just doesn't make any logical sense. So if you think about, for example, the nation of Pakistan, if I were to ask you, do you think that sexism is no longer really a problem for girls and women in Pakistan? I'm guessing that you all are going to say no. And I'm guessing that you're going to say that. You're going to say, no, of course it's still a problem. What are you talking about? You're going to say, of course it's a problem. If I were to say it was gone, right? You would say, no. If I were to say, is it a problem? You would say, yes. Right? And yet this is true, even though what happened in 1988 and again in 1991, a woman, Benazir Bhutto, was elected the head of state there. Right? So they've had a female president in Pakistan. Of course, now she has been assassinated when she was trying to return to the political field again in Pakistan. But she served two terms as head of state. Yet no one would say, well, Benazir Bhutto was head of state in Pakistan. Obviously, sexism is no longer a problem. Girls and women have fully equal opportunity there. Surely we know that. Or if I were to say the same thing about Israel or India or Great Britain, because they've all had female heads of state, right? And no one would look at that and go, well, I'm sure that women in all of those places now are treated fully equally and they don't face any barriers on the basis of sex or gender anymore. We would know that that was untrue. And yet, in a way, what we're being asked to believe in our own country is that the presence of a man of color as president somehow signifies the death of racism. And it makes no more sense here with regard to race than it would make in those places with regard to sex or gender. Right? And finally, let me just tell you this very brief story, and then I'm going to take some questions, because I want you to sort of sit with this for a while. This isn't about coming up automatically with solutions and answers. We will talk about some of that a little bit this evening if you get a chance to come to that one. But to me, the first step in this, whenever we're going to try to get a hold of a problem like racism or any ism, is acknowledging that it sits within us, that it's part of who we are, that we're raised in a culture where we internalize all this stuff. And what the research and the evidence on this says is if we're willing to own that, if we're willing to hold on to that, acknowledge that that is part of who we are, that we've been conditioned to have certain racially prejudicial beliefs, gender prejudicial beliefs, class prejudicial beliefs, that that's just part of growing up in a culture where that stuff is everywhere, then we can actually take action to not act on it. We can resolve to like challenge that in ourselves. We can counter condition our conditioning, right? Same thing with advertising. You know, the reason that advertisers spend hundreds of billions of dollars on ads is because they know it works. They wouldn't do it if it didn't work. So they'll show you ad, and if you know anybody in the ad industry, ask them about this. I've heard it from multiple people in that industry. There's this thing, sort of unwritten rule called the rule of 11. And what the rule of 11 is this idea that it's only after you've heard about a product 11 times that you actually go, damn, I need that, right? So the first 9, 10 times you see the Charmin commercial, you don't know the difference between Charmin and Cottonelle. You don't care. That 11th ad or after is when you're like, I gotta have Charmin. Because God forbid I use, you know, Cottonelle or Baby Soft or whatever, I don't even know what the other ones are, see, because I'm so sold on Charmin, right? But if I use any other one, I'll be chafed for a week, man. I have to get that brand, or you have to have that toothpaste, or you have to have whatever it is, right? And so if that can happen after 11 ads, right, for a product that isn't even that central to your, I mean, yeah, toilet paper is central to your life. I mean, I'm not trying to say it's not. But I'm saying, like, you know, think of it. If you could be sold on a brand of a product after 11 or 12 times of seeing an ad for it, imagine how much easier it is to sell you on race stereotypes and gender stereotypes and economic stereotypes and sexual stereotypes when we're reinforced with that day after day, week after week. We see that stuff all the time from the time that we're kids, even before we're paying attention to product placement. Right? So that's the kind of thing, if we can acknowledge that, it's the same thing with product placement. If I'm really counter-conditioning myself, then I don't have to be moved around the chessboard by those advertisements. I can resist. I can say, no, I don't want Taco Bell at 1 in the morning. No, I don't. I'm not going to go out of here and get, just because you showed me that ad, I'm not going to order a pizza right now. I don't want a pizza. I don't want this. I don't want that. But you have to actually work at that, because otherwise you do sometimes get manipulated. The same is true with racial images, gender, class images. If we can own it, if we can name it, then we can fight it. If we won't own it, won't name it, then we can't fight it because we don't even know it's in the picture. Right? So let me give you the example of what I mean. I would never ask you to do something that I'm not willing to do in the sense of really getting clear on what this all means to you. I've been doing anti-racism work for, you know, professionally for 20 years and you know, 24, 25 years if you go back to my days in college. And yet, By 2004, I think is when this was. So we're talking 6 years ago, but even at that point, I'd been out lecturing around the country for almost 10 years. I've been doing anti-racism work professionally for almost 15 years. And I was headed to a conference, and it was a conference in Iowa, and it was a conference to discuss the issue of white privilege. And so I had to fly through St. Louis from Nashville. So I get on the plane, and I think it's American Airlines, as I recall, and I'm going down the jet bridge, right, and I walk into the airplane, I look into the cockpit, which is a habit I have, I want to make sure somebody's really going to fly this thing, because I still don't understand the aerodynamics of air travel. I don't really get it. I didn't pay attention enough in science to know how it works. I actually don't think it works. I think it's magic, but I don't know for sure. So I look into the cockpit to see if somebody's really going to fly the plane, and sure enough, they're the pilot and the co-captain, and for the first time ever in my life, out of about 1,000 flights at that point that I've been on over a 10-year period, at least 1,000 individual segments of up and down flying, there are two black men at the controls of the plane. That had never happened because, first off, it's very rare. There's like 3% of the pilots in the United States commercial fleet are African-American men. So it's very rare to have even one black pilot. But I had two that day. That's unheard of, right? So I see them. Now, I would ask you to think, knowing what I do for a living and everything, what do you think my first reaction was? Purely instinctual, in my head, sort of thing that goes pops off in my head. We'll make it multiple choice, because, you know, that's how we do in this country. Do you think it was A, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty we are free at last. I cannot wait to get on the phone. Quick, let me do this so I can call all my friends and let them know, my family, and tell them we have reached the moment of aviation equality. Hallelujah, this is wonderful. Right? Or do you think it was more likely something in the realm of B, oh dear God, can these men fly this plane? Now make no mistake, it was B. And make no mistake, I got hold of it just like that. I was able to defeat the thought almost as soon as it came into my head, but not fast enough to keep it from coming into my head. In other words, that thought still popped into my brain, even though intellectually, once I sat down in my seat and thought about it, I realized how ridiculous that was. I was able to process it now, intellectually, good for me. You know, I'm trying to do my work, catch myself and all that. So I catch it, I realize it's crazy, I realize it's a fundamentally racist thought, because I know these two guys probably had to work twice as hard to get in that cockpit. They probably had to prove themselves above those stereotypes that even I'm carrying around with me. So if anything, it's just like when I see a female pilot. The odds are she had to work even harder to get where she's at, right, than a male pilot would have. I know that up here. We all know that up here. But we don't always operate on the basis of what's up here. Sometimes we operate on the basis of a lot of emotional stuff that's subconscious, so we don't even realize it's happening to us. And the fact that we can catch it, I mean, that's good. And think about how deep it is, because in the few months before I got on this plane, hell, I should have been happy to have black pilots. In the couple of months before I got on this plane, there were like two different cases where white pilots had to be hauled off the plane because they were too drunk to fly the plane. So I should have been happy, right? At least they're not white. At least they're not going to be drinking. You know, 3 weeks before, there were two Southwest pilots. You know, they're sort of funny anyway. You know, the Southwest likes to consider themselves real humorous. Like, they're all stand-up comics that just happen to be flying planes until they get their career straight. You know, and... Right, so there were two pilots on Southwest a few weeks earlier that got hauled off and fired because, I don't know if they were drunk or not, but they did think that it would be real funny to take off all their clothes in the cockpit and then invite the flight attendants in as a practical joke. Right? Now, before they even said that these guys were white, I knew they were white. Right? And the reason I knew they were white is not because white folks have a propensity to just like get naked and close quarters and stuff, but it's because no black pilot or any pilot of color would have thought that they would have been able to get away and keep their job with calling some white women into a very closed, confined space, right, with no clothes on. They would have known better. Like, if you're a person of color, you know that will get you fired. These two white men figured, what the hell? I'm sure they won't mind. I'm sure it'll be great. You know, it'll be funny. No, they got fired. But so here I am with these two black men. I ought to at least think to myself intellectually, well, now at least I know they will probably keep their pants on, and they will probably not be drinking. Because they know there are people back here like myself who are sitting there going, oh my God, oh my God. So they're going to make sure they're going to avoid every bump. They're going to avoid every, they're going to hear about turbulence. They're going to go around it. They're going to make sure they don't hit it because they don't want anybody to think. And sure enough, it's like the best flight I was ever on, right? People, when they got down, they clapped, you know? And I don't know, sometimes people just do that anyway, but right, but I'm just saying, like, you know, there were some people who might have been, oh yes, it was awesome. And I totally didn't expect that, you know? right? So that's the thing. The fact that that came into my head, right? I don't feel guilty or it's not that I beat myself up about that. I'm not to blame for that happening, right? That's a result of the conditioning. But the point is, if it can happen to me, even though I intellectually know better, right, then it can happen to anybody. And as long as I'm willing to own that and put that out there, then I can counter condition myself. I can make sure that the next time something comes into my head, I am thinking two or three steps ahead, like on a chessboard, to try to figure out how I'm going to make sure not to act on the thought. It's not the thought that's the problem, because we can get a hold of the thought. It's the action that follows the thought. You know, so the good news is I didn't run from the plane screaming. You know, I didn't freak out and act in a way that was discriminatory, but that's because I've been working on counter conditioning. We have to make that decision. That's a choice we have to make. The programmed thought, we don't choose. It's programmed. It's there. It's been placed there by a lot of things. And as long as we're willing to put that out there and own it, you know, we can get a hold of it. What's interesting is when I told that story for the first time, I told it at University of Wisconsin. And it was a room with about 500 people and about 300 were white, about 200 were folks of color. And it was really interesting what happened, right? This just goes to show how rarely we have honest conversations about this where we just own our stuff, right? Because when I did it, white folks, it looked like they got really nervous, right? And they got really nervous. Like, they looked around kind of nervous, like, oh, I'm afraid that some black people are going to go hurt him now, right? Like, you could actually see white folks are looking around like, how are black people taking this? My goodness, they're probably freaked out, you know? Newsflash, no black people were freaked out. No black folks were even surprised remotely that I had had that response. The only thing that was at all surprising for the folks of color in the room was that I actually put it out there. That was a little different. That was new. They weren't used to that. But it wasn't like they, oh my God, that white man had a racist thought I never would have known. Like that wasn't black and brown folks' reaction. So then all of a sudden when the white folks relaxed and they realized that the stage was not going to get rushed and all this negative stuff was not going to happen, right, then what was really interesting was those white folks started, some of them, started raising their hand and sharing similar stories. Because now that I put my stuff out there, right, they didn't feel as nervous about it, because nobody wants to put their stuff out there first, particularly if you're a student and you're worried like that could affect your grade, or you're a colleague and you're afraid another colleague might see it. So nobody wants to go first, but I had gone first, right? So then other people were like, well, let me tell you about, you know, I'm not real proud about this either, but, and after about five white folks went, then it was really interesting, folks of color start raising their hand, right? And I'd call on them, and then they would say, well, let me tell you now that y'all have been sharing, right? I feel like I can do it. These folks of color said, let me tell you about the time that I, and they talked about the time that a person of color they encountered was in an authority position, and they had the same kind of sort of internalized racist thoughts about their own group, right? The black guy who said, yeah, I had a black pilot, and I had the same thought, or I had a Latino a loan officer at the bank. And then I talked to a friend of mine who's a proud Chicano activist, a proud Latino man in Washington State, right? And he had to take his mom in for heart surgery. And I told him this story, like one-on-one. And he said, you know, what's really messed up is I took my mom in to get heart surgery in Seattle. They lived in Yakima, which is more central Washington. And took her to Seattle to get this open heart surgery and didn't know who the surgeon was going to be. And through the doors comes, you know, Dr. Martinez. You know, and I remember thinking to myself, no, I don't want this Chicano doctor, you know. I want an old white dude with white hair, right? Because that's the sign of excellence, right? He was even thinking that. Now, he caught himself, right? He caught himself and he realized what he was doing. But the fact is, it was there. If that has been conditioned us so much so that even a lot of people of color have those thoughts about themselves, lots of women have those thoughts about other women in positions of authority, lots of working class folks, regardless of race, have that view about working class folks in positions of authority, assuming that they're not as good, not as competent. If that's something that can affect any of us, then it can affect all of us. And part of getting a hold of this and trying to actually change our institutions is not just the personal relationship piece, which, as I said, it's important, though it's not sufficient. It's also understanding that really we've got to be clear on our own stuff. And our own stuff is there no matter how many friends we have across racial lines. Our own stuff is there no matter our relationships across sex and gender lines. Our own stuff is there no matter our relationships around and across lines of class or sexuality. And so if we're really going to be friends to the people we claim to be friends with, that's the first order of business, right? Is getting clear on how even we oftentimes fall prey to that stuff. And I think if we do that, we start to have that conversation honestly, then we can own it, we can get over it, we can have productive dialogue. The thing that's fascinating is that when white folks shut down around race, the research has been done on this. Why do white folks not want to have close relationships with people of color sometimes? Because, oh, we're afraid that we're going to say something racist. And then why do people of color not want to interact across racial lines sometimes? Well, in part, it's because they're afraid they're going to get accused of hypersensitivity, but, you know, it's also a fear. And then what happens is when white folks shut down because we're afraid that we're going to make a mistake and they're going to think we're racist, what people of color say in other research is it's precisely when white folks shut down that they assume that we are racist and must be hiding something. Right? So there's an irony in this. We shut down out of fear that we'll be thought of as racist, and then people of color are like, uh-huh, see? That's why you're not talking. So then we end up having even less connection. We can't even have productive connection because everybody's afraid of some stuff. And if we would just put it out there, have the conversation, be willing to make mistakes, which we all do. And you make a lot of mistakes when you're young. You make a lot of mistakes when you're not so young. Now's the time to make them. You have time to sort of make them, correct them, move through them. But you can't do any of that unless you own them. So thank you all so much for being here and let me share this stuff with you. And I want to take any questions that I have at this time. Thank you.
On behalf of the Diversity Programming Committee, CAT ideas and issues, and this representation of the student body, Tim, we want to thank you. We'll give him another round of applause. Before we take some questions, I want to throw some things out there. There are some green evaluation sheets, so if you can fill those out before you do, that'd be great. Don't leave yet. Also, later tonight, starting at 6:30, we're going to begin the session with some edutainment, if you will, from Amendment 1. So please make your way back to the Villano Room at 6:30 so we can start the night off. And Tim will be beginning at 7 o'clock with another this keynote between Barack and our place. Okay? So again, if you have those,
excellent.
If you can fill out those green sheets, that'd be great. So we have any questions? Anyone?
Yes, sir.
Do you ever receive criticism for being a white male speaking as an anti-racist?
Oh, sure. And, you know, I received that criticism sometimes from other folks who were white, and other times from people of color. And I think when I first started doing this work, and I didn't get too much of that, I wasn't always prepared for when that would come. But one of the first experiences that I had really was a humbling experience, and it led me to understand that criticism was perfectly fair. It made perfect sense. I was in college. I was doing anti-apartheid work at Tulane with regard to South African apartheid during the 80s. It's one of the big movements, right? It was trying to get our schools to divest from companies that were still invested in South Africa under white racist rule. And a lot of white students around the country were involved in it, as were some students of color, actually as was President Obama when he was an undergraduate student at Occidental in the late 70s. But it was a really white-dominated movement. And it was a good cause. It was a legitimate issue. Nothing wrong with doing it. But one of the things that the criticism that I got was not traditional. It wasn't like, why are you doing this? Or how can you do this? Or why should you be doing this? Why should we listen to you? What happened was, one night, my senior year, we were almost at the end of the school year. It was almost time for graduation. We had been camped out in front of our administration building, occupying the lawn in sort of makeshift shanties to reminiscent of some of the housing so prevalent in South Africa at that time, where the poorest of black folks happened to live. And we were on hunger strike. This was the third day of the hunger strike. And it was actually 20 years ago this week. And we were having a forum, and there were students who came over from other schools. And there's a black, historically Catholic school down the road from Tulane, Xavier. And some of the students from Xavier came over, and there was a young woman who's about 18. She's a freshman in college. I was a senior. She stands up during the Q&A, and her first question is, this is great. Well, first she starts off and she says, this is wonderful. Obviously, I think it's horrible that, you know, Tulane is still invested in South Africa. It's ridiculous, and I totally support divestment. I'm glad you're doing what you're doing. But she said, Tim, how long have you lived here? And I said, you know, 4 years. She said, okay, so, and she's from New Orleans, I should point out to you. She said, okay, so in the 4 years that you've been here, can you tell me one concrete thing that you've done to address apartheid in this community, since after all, you benefit from that, right? And it was this brilliant question. It's the kind of question I always tell you when you go to law school, you'd be a good lawyer, you never ask a question you don't already know the answer to. I'm fully convinced she knew the answer to this question, which was I hadn't done anything, really. I'd been so focused on racism 8,000 miles away that I really hadn't dealt with the stuff that was going on down the block that had been going on consistently, the fact that Tulane didn't even recruit at the high school that's 3.5 blocks, 4 blocks away from campus, all black, but they came 540 miles away to Nashville, Tennessee to pluck a very mediocre, low SAT having, mediocre grade having high school student out of Nashville to come to their school. I hadn't even thought about that, but in this moment she called it out. I fumbled the answer terribly, right? Felt like a total idiot afterward. And I was in a daze for weeks, right? Oh my God, it was a criticism, like, in other words, the criticism was never like, you shouldn't be doing this. It was just like, you need to be connecting the dots better, right? It was like, not that it's wrong what you're doing, but you need to do it differently. And that kind of criticism in that moment, I realized, was so fair and so legitimate and so on point, because the truth is, I did have the privilege of picking and choosing issues, like a salad bar. I'll take a little of this, I'll take a little of that. If I get tired of it, I'll switch to this dressing, you know? And people of color didn't have that luxury. They also cared about South African apartheid, but they also had to deal with police brutality in New Orleans. They had to deal with discrimination in New Orleans. They had to deal with, you know, housing inequity in New Orleans. And so that was an amazing moment. Since that time, I mean, I've gotten plenty of criticism. I'll get somebody weekly, and it's not, what it usually is people who are starting off with the assumption that I do this work as charity or out of some altruistic motivation. Like, I'm trying to do this for black folks or for people of color. Other folks sometimes, not to be critical, but they'll say, oh, I like the fact that you see things from a black perspective. No, it's really not a black perspective. I can't see things from the, I can listen to what black people say, and I can start with the assumption that they're not crazy, if that's what you mean, by taking a black perspective. I just start with the assumption that people know their life better than I know their life. And so when people of color tell me this is what they face, I just start with the assumption, okay, it's not that I get that, it's not that I know it, from my own experience, but I can assume that people are not nuts, you know, that people generally know what they deal with. So my perspective is a white ally perspective, or at least an aspiring white ally perspective. I'm trying to stand in solidarity with people of color, both because it's the right thing to do, but also because I think white folks are actually harmed by this system in the long run. I think that in the long run, systems of racial inequity damage the whole community. I think they damage the trust and the bonds between people. I know that they tore apart those friendships. That's what I was talking about. Like, at the most personal level, it hurt me. I suffered a loss because of systemic inequity, right? And right now, if you think even just at the psychological level, we have an economic meltdown, and it's fascinating to watch. I mean, it's horrible, and it's scary, but it's also interesting because, think about this, like, double-digit unemployment is not new for everybody, right? Like, there are entire communities of millions of people who've been used to that. That's been perfectly normal forever. Black folks, double-digit unemployment, the norm. Latino folks, double-digit unemployment, the norm. Southeast Asian folks, the norm in this country. For people of color, this is like every day. It's a more extreme version of it, maybe, but double-digit unemployment is not new. It's not a revelation. For white Americans, we haven't faced this in three generations, double-digit unemployment, 75 years since whites as a group collectively had to deal with that. So all of a sudden, the folks that aren't used to it, because we had the privilege and the advantage of not having to worry about it, now we're like melting down. Like, oh my God, what do you mean? I don't know where my job's going to come from. I don't know if I'm going to have health care. I don't know if I'm going to have a house. Really? Because that has been perfectly normal for millions of people. And if we had thought it was a crisis when black teenagers had a 42% unemployment rate, right, which is what they had 10 years ago when the economy was good, was 42%, right? Then maybe we'd have stepped in and done something to stop that from spreading. If the subprime mortgage crisis, which was first happening in black and brown communities, had been thought of as a crisis there, maybe it wouldn't have spread. We would have stopped in and done something, but we didn't. So it seems to me like, in a way, that inequality that we take for granted when it's only affecting the other, eventually it gets around, you know? It comes around. And it will hit everybody. So I actually, the reason I do this work, it is not charity. It is self-help. It is very much about recognizing that this thing has a consequence for me. There are a lot of other examples of it, but I think, and so sometimes when people write to me and they say, you know, it's paternalistic for you to do this work. If my motivation was charity, that would be perfectly right. I try to always explain, you know, that really it's not that, but I understand the criticism because I'm sure that has been a motivation for white folks historically. And I'm sure that that's probably how I got into it. When I first started, it probably was that. It probably was that whole, you know, like, in fact, I remember being asked by people of color in New Orleans, like, why do you care about this? And I said something ridiculous like, you know, well, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Not that that's ridiculous. Not that that's a ridiculous line, but it ain't my line. Like, that was somebody else's line, is Dr. King's line, and I jacked it and thought it was really brilliant of me, you know. And the people of color I said that to were like, okay, keep working at that and get back with us when you come up with something that's really about you. And I had to do that. And that was, so I think the criticisms that we get are very valid, because I think people of color have every reason to feel like they've been burned by white allies before. And I think women have every right to look at men when we say we're about something and go, all right, you know, that's fine, but we need you to show that over and over again, repeatedly. And, you know, I just think that that the criticism that comes is legitimate. It doesn't mean that every critique is legitimate, but the concept of criticism or the concept of having to really demonstrate makes perfect sense given the record, you know, and I'm glad for it because I think it keeps me honest and I think it keeps other white folks honest when we have to constantly sort of demonstrate with that we're trying to be accountable, that we're that there's integrity in what it is we're trying to do. So yes, it happens, and yes, I think it's good. Yes.
Curious as to what are some of the benefits of white people in creating a system of equality?
Right. Well, one is, to the extent that you actually do value those cross-racial connections, friendships, and relationships, it makes those possible at an authentic level. So if that really matters to you, which we claim that it does, I know some are telling the truth and others are not, then that will never happen in a system of inequity and privilege. But more importantly than that, a couple things. One, and I alluded to it a second ago, I think that a system of privilege almost inevitably sets the people who have it up to not understand the way the world works. And so whether that's the way the economy works, and we're seeing now the consequences of being ignorant about that, and all of a sudden, you know, this double-digit unemployment, economic insecurity, we're not ready for it because privilege has insulated us from some of the worst consequences of economic downturn historically. Whether it's 9/11, I mean, I've used this example many times. I think, you know, when you don't understand the way the world works, it's actually very unsafe. To be a person of color, 9/11 wasn't shocking. It was scary, it was frightening, it was upsetting, but people of color did not, I defy anybody to find me a clip. I have asked for this clip for almost a decade now, since 9/11 of 2001. Find me one clip from a news show where a person of color says in the wake of 9/11, why do they hate us? Good luck, you will not find one. Now, it's not because people of color were any less horrified or upset by what happened, but to be a person of color is to have to know what other people think about you. It's how you stay alive. You don't have the luxury of thinking that everything is goodness and light in America, whereas a lot of white folks, I'm not saying all white folks have that belief, but we have the luxury of having that belief. White folks have never really had to know what other people think, because what are you going to do, fool? You know, what are you going to do to me? I will bomb you. I will kill you. I will bomb you back to the Stone Age. And if you're already there, I will take you back to whatever came before the Stone Age, because I can. Like, that's the thing privilege does. But then, you know, 13 guys or whatever it is with box cut, 19 guys with box cutters and a bone to pick are like, okay, cool. You can spend your $400 billion a year on defense, and me and my boys are bringing these buildings down anyway. How do you like us now? And we're like, duh. Better go read a book on Islam to understand why they hate us so much, which misses the point as well, right? So I think that privilege is dangerous in that sense. And I think the reason we would benefit from greater equity is that we would be forced to confront the realities that eventually we will have to confront anyway, whether it's economic or foreign policy realities or ecological catastrophe or militarism and all the stuff which right now we seem so bent out of shape about because we don't get it. We can't see it. There are some other examples. There's a great book called The Price of Privilege, which came out a couple years ago, written by a psychotherapist in Northern California, a woman by the name of Madeline Levine. And her book looks at affluent white, she doesn't name them as white, but she's in Marin County, California. So if anybody knows Marin, it's a very white place for the most part. And her clientele, I've since had confirmed, overwhelmingly white. She's talking about how the affluent white kids who are coming in, she's a juvenile psychologist, she works with young teenagers and, you know, adolescents, and she says they are manifesting some of the most obvious signs of psychological distress she's ever seen. Stuff that we don't classify as at-risk children, because you know what that means. At-risk, we always talking about black and brown folks in the city. We never want to say what they're at risk of, right? We leave that part out. They're just at-risk youth. At risk of what? Racism? Oh, at risk of what? Economic exploitation? No, not that. Just at risk of some crazy stuff that we don't know what it is and we don't want to name. Well, what she's saying is you got these privileged kids who in every way have relative advantage over the kids in, let's say, East Oakland, right? Not that far away. Next county over. So they have all these advantages, and yet, right, they are manifesting the highest levels of substance abuse, the highest levels of parental alienation, the highest levels of rage disorders, the highest levels of eating disorders, the highest levels of self-mutilation and self-injury disorders. They're the ones who are going away to college, and then they yell at their parents when they don't get their credit card sent to them on time, and they're screaming. And I've seen this on campuses where I'll be on campus, and there'll be some inevitably white student who is like, damn it, Mom, where's my, you know, and I mean, and the black folks will look at them like, what? Like, what? Damn it, Mom? You know, like, and then just,
can I have your side of the room? What do you mean? Well, because she's going to come kill you now, right? And there's like this whole, so what this Madeline Levine book talks about, The Price of Privilege, is how there's, to an extent, privilege can soften you to a point where you just can't deal with setback. You can't deal with setback. It's why, if you look at the Great Depression, 1929, going into 1930, they have all those images, you've seen this stuff, or you've heard about people jumping off the tops of buildings when the stock market crashed. Who was that? Was that poor people? Did poor people go, wait, I'm going to climb that building and throw myself off because the stock market crashed? No, poor people of all colors were in the soup line. And they were like, okay, stock market crashed, I'm going to get this soup. And rich people were like, oh, I must kill myself because I can't cope with being poor. And the poor folks are like, there's plenty of soup. Y'all can just, we'll save you some. There's a lot of soup. We won't eat all of it. You know, stock market. What? You know, I mean, it's just, so it just seems to me that privilege, I mean, I know it's all good until it's not. Right? It's all good until it lets you down. And it can let you down at times when you least expect it. Columbine High School, 1999. That's one of those times when those white folks who moved to Littleton, Colorado, got out of Denver, and they were real proud of themselves. Because they got out of the city. Oh, we moved out to the suburbs where it's safe. And then Klebold and Harris killed 13 people. Oh, wow. Maybe it wasn't so safe. And then afterward, everybody was like, this wasn't supposed to happen here. Well, now, mass murder wasn't supposed to happen anywhere, fool. But oddly enough, mass murder seems to happen in those places more often than in the city where it's like retail violence. That's wholesale, right? Wholesale killing. And so privilege, you know, let people think they were, because they got out of a bad part of town, whatever that means. You know, and I know that doesn't cut it all the time. So I think that there are real self-interest reasons why privileged folks ought to think long-term. When we think short-term, it's all positive. Long-term, not so much. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm in Foresight Organization Communication. You mentioned the rule of 11 in advertisements. Mm-hmm. I wanted to address racial stereotypes here at this institution or other institutions. Mm-hmm. My question is, how can organizations, specifically a higher education institution, help condition students away from racism?
I think the first thing we have to do is acknowledge that they're out there. Now it's tricky, right? Because I've been in settings where I've seen people do this, and I think this is dangerous. Unless people really know each other well. I've been in settings where it's like a workshop, maybe even like an orientation program, and somebody says, "So, what are the stereotypes about Asian people?" And we're going to put them up on the wall. And there are Asian folks in the room. And that's like, you know, it's not that we don't all know what they are and what the stereotypes of black folks are and the stereotypes of Jews and the stereotypes. I mean, the fact is, if I say that to you, you know in your head exactly what they are. We've heard them. We know what they are. Kids as early as 8, 9, 10 years old have heard a lot of these and know what they are. But to do it in a mixed room can be dangerous. Now, on the other hand, you can get away with doing this if you have like white folks processing by themselves. Black folks processing by themselves, maybe Latinos processing by themselves. You know, if you split folks up into different groups where they can just process amongst themselves and not have to put their stuff in front of other people, maybe that kind of thing can work. But I think more importantly, it's just about acknowledging that stereotypes, I think showing media clips, I talked to colleges about doing orientation programs, doing res hall programs, a really good example of residence hall educational programs where, you know, you got to have food or people won't come, I get it. But like you do a res hall program where you talk about media imagery. And you can make that really, it's both entertaining and it's informative in the sense that, I mean, back when Chappelle was on, for example, just to give you an example of what a few schools did, I would get asked questions about Chappelle. And like, how do we deal with this? People kept telling me like, oh, you know, we got these problems. They have to do with the Chappelle show and the fact that the white students have downloaded these sound files of Dave Chappelle using the N-word, and then they put them on their computer. Every time they boot up their computer, it's Dave Chappelle yelling that. And then the black student who's their roommate is like, really? 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 That's your opening sound? Really? You know? And then the white student will be like, but it's not me saying it. It's Dave Chappelle saying it. And they're like, you don't get it. I don't know what you're thinking when you put that on, you know. So what do we do? And I would say, well, I think y'all need to have a program where you talk about this just openly and honestly. And one of the ways you do it, you pop in a tape, you show the episode, you have a conversation about it, because people are already watching it. People are already watching Chappelle, drawing their own conclusions about what he's saying. I happen to think he's brilliant. I happen to think he's not only like the most brilliant comic in the last 15 years, but he's one of the most brilliant social commentators. Now, if you know his history and background, you understand why. His mom was one of the first African American studies professors in the United States. He grew up in Yellow Springs, Ohio, next to Antioch College, where he was
was getting this radical education. His mom was an advisor to Patrice Lumumba, the former head of the Congo, who was assassinated with the help of this country, by the way, but that's another lecture for another night. And so Chappelle, when he was doing his stuff, that was like really radical anti-racist content. The problem is, not everybody was up to speed on that. Right? So if you know the story about why he walked away because he concluded that white folks might not be getting the joke. Like, he was not saying, if you think about the skit, and the first time I saw the reparation skit, which I think is one of the funniest skits I've ever seen in any kind of sketch comedy or variety show, right? Hilarious skit, where the whole thing is, what would happen if black folks got reparations, and they back up like a truck full of cool cigarettes and 40-ounce bottles of malt liquor to the hood, right? And then everybody runs, rushes the truck or whatever, and the point of his doing this skit was not to say that's what black people would do. It was to make fun of the fact that there are people who think that. It's making fun of the stereotype, making it so absurd, and poking fun at the people who think that mess. But the first time that skit was on, I was at a college, I don't remember which one, I was staying on campus, they had a food court down below my campus apartment. I came down about 10 o'clock or whatever time it was on to get something to eat. And I come down and I'm dressed in just casual clothes and you know, and I didn't have facial hair at the time, I looked a little bit younger, my kids were little, they hadn't sucked the life out of me yet. So I get down, I look like I could just be a student, I'm blending in with these students, and I'm watching, and these young white men are watching the Chappelle Show in this food court on TV, and he's doing the reparation skit, and this white guy looks at one of his buddies and he's like, that is exactly what they would do. He was trying to make fun of the notion that he was having to mask, right? And that was the point of the skit, but the cameraman, white dude who he's worked with at that point for 3 years, knows him well, is laughing, and he goes, God, he's laughing a little too hard. Like, I don't know if he's laughing with me or at me. So then he says, I don't think white people get my, I got to walk away from $50 million. Right? That takes integrity that I don't think most of us have. That's pretty heavy. But all we heard was he was crazy. He was insane. Not insane. That was integrity. But the thing is, you could have a whole conversation about that. You show the clip. You have a conversation about, well, what is really being said here? Now, is it going to be tense a little bit? Maybe. Could somebody say something stupid and wrongheaded? Absolutely. But the fact that we've got something entertaining and even humorous at first help break some of that defensiveness down, I think is one way that we can have the conversation without having to put the burden on an individual student, who after all, particularly if you're like a first year student, it's not fair to expect an 18-year-old traditional age college student to come in and just put all their stuff out without some kind of tool to bring. It's not going to happen. I mean, most of us are not going to do that at 18. I probably wouldn't have at 18. So I think that having some kind of thing that'll break some of the ice like that, using media, looking at advertising, since we mentioned the rule of 11, looking at movies, looking at sketch comedy stuff, looking at video games, music videos, and really having a conversation. What are the images we're getting around gender? What are the images we're getting around race? What are the images we're getting around class? And I can do this exercise with, and I have asked that question with like 10-year-olds, 5th grade, 11-year-olds. Right? Where do we get our images? Where do we get our ideas about racial others? And these 10-year-old kids will raise their hand and they'll be like, you know, some video game they played. Right, or some TV show they saw, or some movie they saw, so they know at 10 or 11. They just are looking for the opportunity to talk about that. You're not necessarily asking them, what is your view? You know, which maybe they're not ready to do, certainly at 11. You know, you're not trying to out them as having these biases. But what you're trying to say is, where do we get our ideas, and what are those ideas? And then they can point to this thing that's sort of apart from them. Even though, in effect, if I say, well, the message we're getting is that this group is blah, 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 even if I'm not owning that that's part of my view, I'm acknowledging that that's out there. And I'm acknowledging that that's part of it, and then I can actually begin to work on it. You know,
Tim, two more questions.
Yes.
And we're going to end up.
Okay, very good, very good. So we're here and then here.
You,
oh, I'm sorry, you're back there. Oh.
Yeah, right here.
Okay, and then I'll come to you. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
I was just going to bring up while we're like sitting here, there's like something that in all of this that we have been inviting ourselves even in the audience.
Yeah.
And kind of how that works at Philadelphia, 2010, we've all had a diversity requirement. Yeah. About this in class and kind of why are white people being less likely to engage in the conversation? Mm. Are we sitting like back maybe because we get a little bit nervous about it? Are we grouping first?
Right.
So we know each other, but we still have this social dynamic here where we might not be like bridging that.
Yeah.
And I guess it's just been a frustrating thing for me to like see and witness, and maybe it's on the part of both groups that we need to be engaging with each other in other ways to be like offensive, to be publicized in a way that's going to make more interest within the group white students versus we know, you know, you have things organized in multicultural affairs
right.
and things like that. So it was just interesting to point at have even been set ourselves up here to talk about.
Well, you know, I mean, I think here's the thing. I don't want to draw too much out of it, because I think that, you know, people come to events with their friends who they were hanging out with right before they were coming to the event. So I never make too much out of that, because I think that, you know, you just come with whoever you were just hanging out with or whatever. And I also know that on a mostly white campus, two things will be true. I mean, folks of color will bond together and will sometimes cleave to one another out of a sense of just feeling, wanting to feel normal in even a smaller unit, like at a microcosm level. So it makes sense. And I never draw, and by the same token, white folks, for different reasons, and maybe with less validity in the sense of feeling afraid of, because it's got to be harder for a person of color at a mostly white place than for a white person at a mostly white place. But, you know, but nonetheless, we too, if we come from places where we didn't have a lot of interaction, we don't know how to do it either. So I just sort of take it as it is what it is. When you come into a place, that's where people maybe are initially going to go. What a school's obligation is to just make sure there are enough opportunities for two things to happen, right? Number one is for that cross-racial conversation to take place. So we're going to create some deliberate spaces where that's going to happen. That might be at the orientation process when students first come in. It might be in the residence halls. We're going to deliberately make that conversation happen across racial lines. And then secondly, the other thing they need to facilitate is intra-group conversation. In other words, it's important for us, those of us who are white, when we're just among white folks, to also have some time that we can sit and talk about, like, what does that mean? What does it mean? What do we do to be better allies? What can we do to stand in solidarity? What can we do to challenge racism, not for them, right, and not even with them in the room necessarily, but just when we're on our own? Because the reality is 85% of white folks will leave college and go back to communities where there are very few people of color. So we're going to be in white space for a while, and a lot of times, what are we going to do when we're just among white people? We could still be doing anti-racism work and education and challenging so that the institution changes over time and we get those connections that we're looking to have. And people of color too. If people of color are encouraged to have and their space made available for them to process the stuff that they're dealing with in mostly white space, then they're going to feel more comfortable reaching out across racial lines. Everybody, though, like I said, is holding back for reasons that make perfect sense to them and which are totally understandable. One group's afraid of looking racist. The other group's afraid of being dismissed and, you know, accused of hypersensitivity. The only way we're going to get through that is to create some intra-group dialogue and some inter-group dialogue, and then folks will do what they'll do. And not everybody's going to engage in either of those or both of them. But if we make the opportunity, it can happen. And I think that's what I've seen at a lot of schools. Let's come here, and then I'll go right here. Because, yeah, go ahead. Okay.
You mentioned that, you know how you said you had like a group of friends and it consists of all types of people. Mm-hmm. How would you address a situation where, for example, say if you're out with some of your white friends and they make racist jokes or like brought up racist ideas? Do you think that you would be more defensive, or would you ignore it? Well, I know as an anti-racist.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what I do, and this is my recommendation to any, certainly to any white person in the room who I think, if we're being honest, we've had these opportunities to challenge before and we've failed often. Just to put it in perspective, those journals that I told you about, the 626 students, out of those 626 students and 7,500 blatantly racist incidents, only one of those students intervened and challenged the behavior. So they chronicled it, but they didn't step in, which says a lot. But here's what I do. Several years ago, I was nervous about how I was going to handle these moments because they kept happening and I didn't like my response. I usually did one of two things. I either got really pissy with the person and yelled at them, and then that didn't do anything. It just made my blood pressure go up. It, you know, it didn't solve the problem. The best case scenario was that that person would never make the mistake of telling a racist joke when I'm around again. But that didn't mean they weren't going to do it generally. They just make sure I wasn't there, right? So that didn't help. And the other reaction was even worse, which was sometimes I would find myself just blowing it off and not doing anything, right? Just sort of laughing it off. Oh, that's terrible, huh? You know, and then hope that the moment would pass. And that was even worse because I knew that was collaborating with the joke or with the racist comment. So I finally decided I had to have a different approach. And I practiced my approach for weeks in the mirror. And you'll understand why in just a second because it took some practice. And then sure enough, a couple months after I solidified this approach, my plan B, right, I got the opportunity. I was speaking in a really white community. I think it was in North Dakota, somewhere where, you know, really overwhelmingly white. And after the talk, students who took me out to eat, we went to like Applebee's or Bennigan's or some chain to eat dinner, and we're sitting around, and they're all white folks that brought me and were on this committee, and we're sitting around at this big table, we're having dinner, and another kid comes up who's a, you know, student at the college who didn't know me, and my picture had not been out on the posters, and at that point I looked really young, and I could totally, you know, fit in as a student, and so he had no idea why I was there, who I was, and I was dressed pretty casually, and so he asked if he can join us. And he didn't know everybody at the table. He knew like three of the other people, and the rest he didn't know. But he said, can I join y'all? And we're like, oh yeah, that's fine. So he sits down, and we keep talking about just class stuff and just, you know, where people are from and stuff. And he finally, after a few minutes of us just hanging out, not talking about my subject matter, not talking about the speech, not giving any indication of what I'm there for, he says, hey, do y'all want to hear a joke? And I did not want to hear a joke, because I knew, like I just knew, this was going to be one of those white bonding moments that most of us have had, where we're just around other white folks and all of a sudden they think it's totally fine to cut loose with some crazy racist stuff. Just like those of us who are men have had these male bonding moments where some guy like looks at us and makes some sexist comment like we're supposed to be okay with that. And most of us have had that, whether we want to admit it or not. So I'm sitting there, I'm like, I don't want to hear it, but it's coming. So we say yes. He tells this horribly racist joke about black folks. Now, it's an interesting moment, right? Because the committee knows why they brought me. They know why I'm there, and they just saw this dude tell this racist joke in front of this anti-racist guy. So they sit back, they're like, oh, this is going to be good. They're excited now. They're really happy. They're like, oh, this is going to be great. But I have a plan, and they don't know what my plan is, so I have to implement it. And I implement the plan. Everybody else is like, oh. And I started laughing like it was the funniest joke I'd ever heard. This was my plan. And you're probably thinking, well, that's what the committee was thinking. The committee was like, wait a minute. We paid this dude good money to come in here and be anti-racist. And now he's laughing at a racist joke. What? Can we cancel the check? What is this? Like, this is not good. But I sold it. I had to sell this guy, right, on the fact that I was sincerely thinking he was funny. So I did, man. I cracked up. I laughed, made it real. And then I looked at him and I said, I got one. You want to hear it? And he goes, yeah. I said, did you hear the one about the white guy who told the really racist joke in front of a bunch of people he didn't know because he assumed that they were also white like him? And I looked at him just like I'm looking at you right now. And he looked back and he's like, no, what's the punchline, you know? And I'm thinking, dude, you're it, you know? But he thought there was a joke there. I said, well, actually, there's no joke. That was just my way of telling you that I'm black, that my mom is black. And I looked at him just like I'm looking at him. And see, some of y'all believed it too. Y'all are like, that's why. Y'all are like, now I get it. It's a total lie. That's the part I had to practice in the mirror for 3 weeks, right? Because it's not true, but I had to practice it so I wouldn't give it away with my face. So I looked at him just, my mom is black, yeah, I'm black. I consider myself black. Now, what do you think he did? Oh, he apologized. He turned 5 shades of red, right? He turned as red as your jacket. He was humiliated, and he said, oh my God, I'm so sorry. If I'd known, I never would have told that joke. At which point I said, well, actually, that's all right. I'm not black. My mom is white. But I am sort of curious. I said, like a second ago when you thought I was black, you apologized. So you know at some level that was messed up, right? That you shouldn't have done that. And before he could say anything, now keep in mind, at this point I'm not being angry or hostile or even really adversarial. I'm just like, you sort of know, right? Because you apologized, so you know that was messed up. So I'm not being angry. I'm not putting him on the defensive. And then before he could say anything, though, I wanted to keep going. I said, so I need you to tell me why it is that you think so little of your own people. And he said, huh? Because, you know, he knew he didn't think much of black people. That's why he told the joke. But that's not what I asked him. I didn't care why he didn't like black folks, because there was nothing I could do for him on that anyway. But I wanted to know, and I asked him, why is it you think so little of your own people? And he was like, what do you mean? And I said, well, it seems to me like it's a little risky for you to come in front of a group of white folks who you don't know, at least some of them you don't know, and to presume that it's okay to rock some racist joke like that says to me that you don't think very much of white folks, you just assume we're all bigots, right? You just assume that all white folks are the kind of racists that like hearing racist humor. So why do you think so little of your own group, right? Because see, I'm thinking to myself, if I had stood up and said, all white people are bigots, this dude would have been furious. And he said, that's not fair. You're generalizing. Hell, I didn't say it, dude. You said it, right? By virtue of your behavior, you just said that. And I'm wondering why. And he was just like, his head exploded. Like it was, like he did that thing that dogs do when they hear a high-pitched whistle. You know, it was sort of like that. And And we ended up having a conversation about race that lasted for a good half hour. And I've had at least 6 or 7 other opportunities to do this. And every time the thing, which I clearly need to hang out with some different white people, I suppose, but because it keeps happening, you know, no matter what. But the thing is, every time it works, and every time, instead of having an argument and being real adversarial and defensive and pissy and angry, we end up having a really good conversation. But how do you know what you know? Because what that young man is taking for granted in that moment is not just that all white folks are racist the way he is, but that all white folks are so devoid of any ethical compass around this that we're going to think it's funny. And men do the same thing with sexism. Like, if you tell a sexist joke around me or make some denigrating comment about a woman, and you think I'm going to laugh and be okay with that, you are disrespecting men. It's clear you're disrespecting women, but you're also disrespecting men because you're assuming, it's almost like you're going up to men and say, okay, so we're all jackasses here, right? Okay, cool. Right? We're all pigs, right? Yes, okay, good. You know, like, really? Because if a woman were to say all men are pigs, we'd be, rah, 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 rah. But if a man basically by his behavior, like, demonstrates that he thinks that, then we're like, huh? You know, so I just feel like that to me, and what I've learned about that, now obviously you can't use that approach if people know, you're like with family, you can't get away with that. You say, I'm black. Well, no, you're not. You know, I know you're not. But people of color can do that with, look, people of color can do it with religion, when people make denigrating comments about Muslims, which happens all the time now. Folks who are not Muslim can take ownership of that and try to have the same conversation. Folks make heterosexist or homophobic comments. Folks of any race can talk about that. Folks make comments about poor folks of any color. Anybody can take that. And I just think it's an interesting way, because the thing is, next time that young man is in front of people he doesn't know, here's the thing that's going to be going through his mind. I know this now. It wouldn't have gone through his mind before because he was taking certain things for granted. But the next time he's thinking about telling that joke or even one remotely like it, he's going to have to ask himself one question. Are these really white people? Or are these some of those black white people? Right? And by that I mean he's going to have to ask whether or not there is unanimity in his crew. And if he doesn't know for a fact that there is unanimity amongst the people he's with, he is going to pull back and not do it. And the thing about that is, see, again, if you want to be a racist and think racist thoughts and yell them at your dog in your house in the privacy of your own home, I don't know too many people of color who care one way or the other. It's when you bring that stuff out, right, and actually act on it and do stuff with it. And just like anti-racism takes practice, racism does too. If we don't let them get their practice in on us, and at our expense, then they don't get as good at what they're trying to do. And so it throws racist off balance. It throws sexist off balance. It throws heterosexist off balance whenever you intervene in a way that makes them have to question the things they take for granted. And so I think that that's the kind of approach which it's more productive. It tends to work. But even easier, if you don't have time for that, even easier approach. Sometimes, and I'll do this if I don't have time, is I'll just, somebody will say something and I'll just be like, wait, what was that? I think I missed that. Right? Now you might think, well, what does that do? Well, here's what it does. It's fascinating. I always say it when it's obvious I heard it. Like, if the person whispered it, I wouldn't try that because I might. But it's like, it was blatant, it was obvious, and it was high decibel, and I still was like, wait, hold on, what was that? I think I missed that. And every time I do it, the person backs off. It's almost like they know they did something wrong. Oh, I stepped in it. Oh, I don't want to step in it again. They either change the comment or they go, oh, nothing, nothing, nothing. Right? So it's just sort of like one of those things at the most basic level, when you don't have the time to go through this whole rigmarole, that you can just say, wait, hold on. And all of a sudden, they're starting to wonder, oh, wait, maybe this person, I can't do this, you know. So it just, I think part of it is thinking it through. Part of it is thinking, if this happens, what am I going to do? What am I going to say? Because I was able to think about it for weeks, plan it, and then respond. What we usually do is we get caught off guard, and we're not ready, and then we get sort of stunned that something racist happened, and we don't know what to say. Right here, and then we're done. Yeah.
You talked a little bit about your children, and you mentioned that you had some. And you mentioned how the system shaped you, and it shapes all of us. It generalizes superiority, and it generalizes superiority for white people. So those same structures exist that told you who you were.
Right.
And so those structures are telling your children who
Absolutely.
They are.
Absolutely.
What are you doing in your family to help your children to grow up with them? Yeah. Accurate sense of who they are.
Yeah, we have to have this conversation all the time. I'm going to tell a story tonight that I won't tell now, A, because it's long, and B, because I want it to be new for folks when they come this evening, but about my oldest daughter making a comment that clearly demonstrated that she had internalized some of this and how we dealt with it. But I'll just tell you generally that what we tried, you know, we knew early on, and there's very little that, in terms of parenting, that I would have more of an insight, not insight, but just be more, further along than my wife on. Most of it she would be further. This is the one area my wife is like, hey, what do we do with this? You know, and I'm like, oh, this part I know. You know, like I'm good on this. So here's what we do, you know. And we still make mistakes. But what's interesting is I knew early on, for example, that I was going to have to make a decision about what she would be exposed to in terms of media. Like, do I keep her from seeing certain things because the images are jacked up, or is she okay to see that stuff, and then we talk about it. And I resolved it by saying, no, I'm gonna let her see the stuff. I'm gonna let her see Disney films, but we're gonna have conversations. And she may decide she doesn't like Disney films because every time we have to have a conversation, but whatever. I didn't want to be one of those parents that said, oh, I don't let my kid watch TV or watch movies because it's horrible, because that kid's gonna be the one that turns out to be 15 and has no critique of the stuff they never saw. Like, I'd rather go ahead and let them develop the critique. So, because I grew up on all that nonsense and I still develop the critique. I mean, I grew up on Lone Ranger stuff and just like messed up stuff, you know. So with the girls watching Disney films, getting these images of not just race images, but gender images, class images. I mean, the princess movies are just like, historically, particularly the evil three, you know, Snow White and Cinderella and Sleeping Beauty, those are just, I mean, awful. The messages about like royalty, yeah, how'd they get all that property? Oh, I'm sure they earned it, you know. You know, the images of women, oh yeah, what your highest call in life should be is to fall asleep and have some dude you don't know kiss you. And that's not sexual harassment, that's romance. What? You know, or the racial images, like, why is Snow that damn white? She doesn't have to be that white, you know, but they make her that white. So there are all these crazy things. And we were about to have conversations about that, and then ended up having one had to jump the line. It was Pocahontas, which is the most jacked up movie when it comes to the racial stuff that Disney, except for maybe Jungle Book, that Disney has ever put out. Which I didn't let her see Jungle Book. That was the one. I'm like, I'm gonna draw the line somewhere, and that's it. You know, it's gonna be that one. But Pocahontas was, and I didn't even want her to watch it, but then I said, okay, I'm gonna let her do it. We got the DVD, she watched it, and what was interesting though, it gave, and she was only four when she saw it, was it gave us an opportunity, and it's one we've come back to with other examples since, to have this conversation. After it was over with, we watched some of the special scenes and special like features, and there was one part that was really interesting that I was able to use as a teaching tool, and it was this part where the chief illustrator was talking about his process, and he was showing the drawings, early drawings of Pocahontas from the film, and I think it was maybe before the film was released. He was at a convention or something, and he was previewing it, and so he's showing these images of Mapalaka, which is her real name, and before white folks changed it and stole her and took her to England. But here's Mapalaka, his image, right, which is this, as you know, very glamorized, very sexualized, frankly Asianized woman in terms of the way they make her look on the screen. And then he shows the historic Mapalaka, and there's only one known image that I've seen, which is the one after she goes to England, and she's got the big collar, and she looks like, you know, she's been turned into a fully functional English woman. And of course, if you've seen Mapalaka's actual face, you know that she has traditionally indigenous American facial features, she has a broad nose, she has and so she doesn't fit the traditional Western image of beauty. And certainly not compared to this sexualized image that this guy's made. And he tells a joke about it. He basically makes fun of it. He looks out at the audience full of illustrators or whatever, and he says, well, as you can see, we stayed very true to the original. And the crowd thinks it's hilarious. I'm guessing there were no American Indian illustrators in the room. They wouldn't have probably thought it was very funny. But everybody thinks it's hilarious that he's basically just denigrated her as a woman and denigrated her ethnicity and nationality, race, quote-unquote, background. So I look at my daughter at this point, and you know, I know this is going over her head, so we need to talk about this stuff. So we turn it off, and I said, what I've learned with kids is two things. Number one, you can go really deep. You just can't stay long, right? You have to get in and get out, because the clock is running. There's a very short time frame, but you can go deeper than you think at an earlier age than you think. And the second thing I've learned is that the best process for young people is to ask them questions rather than just giving them answers. Because, you know, the stuff we tell our kids as parents, when we're the parents and they're the child, that stuff goes in one ear, out the other about all kinds of things, whether they're important or not so important. But if you ask questions and lead young people to the answers themselves, you manipulate them, you're trying to get them to the answers that you want them to have. But it's a process that will stick with them. So what I did was I looked at her and I said, tell me, why do you think they changed her from that to that? And at first she said, I don't know, right? Which is a standard 4-year-old answer, probably a standard 14-year-old answer. But standard 40-year-old answer for that matter. I mean, whenever we talk about race, I don't know is like always the answer. But anyway, she says, I don't know. I said, well, what do you think? And she said, I don't know. Maybe they think that she's prettier this way. And I said, yeah, maybe. I said, if you were Native American, if you were Powhatan, which is what Pocahontas or Matawaka was, how would you feel about the fact that they didn't think that you were pretty enough and they had to change you? And she said, I think that would really hurt my feelings. I think it would make me sad. I said, yeah, what if somebody wanted to make a movie about your life 400 years from now? And of course she interrupted me and she was like, cool, you know. I said, no, that's not what I'm getting at. I said, what if someone wanted to make a movie about your life and they didn't like your red hair and your fair skin, because she's like alabaster white, like she is translucent, I don't know what they're like, white, you know. And with red hair. And I said, what if they didn't like your red hair and your fair skin and they wanted to make you look different? How would that make you feel? I think I would feel really bad. And so now that day, that was the whole conversation. We just left with, I'm getting her to think about gender, getting her to think about beauty and race and all this other stuff. And we've since had many, many conversations. The other thing we had to do was really deliberately construct opportunities for interaction where not only would she be interacting with folks of color, because again, that notion that all we need is contact, we know that's not true. That was the theory back in the 50s, was the contact hypothesis, that if we just got folks together, everything would be fine. Really what you have to have is you have to have interrelationship where there's interdependence, and you have to have authority figures of color. What made a difference for me was going to that preschool where the authority figures were black women. It wasn't just that the kids were black kids, it was that the women who ran the program were black women. So being that little kid in that preschool where I'm being subordinated to black authority at the age of 3 in 1971, even in 2010, white folks are not subordinated to black authority very often. So to have that happen at an early age is critical because it teaches respect for authority across a spectrum of color. Right? So we had to figure out ways, and so we had different ways of doing it, and it's a different time than in the early 70s, but it meant, you know, our kids go to, they dance, they do ballet, tap, jazz, and hip-hop, and three out of like the 6 instructors that the oldest one has had have been authority figures of color who are the instructors. They're a kindergarten teacher, black woman, go to a school that's multiracial and diverse and has authority figures of color, not as many as we'd like, but some in very key positions. So we have these sort of socially structured opportunities, and I think for white families in particular, making sure that our kids have more than just contact, but high-level contact with authority figures of color so that they get used to seeing people of color, not just like, oh, they turn on the TV and there's President Obama and he's a man of color, because what the research says is that has absolutely no effect on the tendency for people to stereotype black people generally, because it's so remote. It's like, yeah, there's a black man, or there's Oprah Winfrey, or there's a person of color who's in a position of authority, but if I don't know them, they don't teach me anything about what I should assume about the larger society. On the other hand, what the research says is that when folks have in their own life people of color in positions of authority, whether they're white or children of color, because like you said, there's an internalized piece. So if it's a child of color and all the doctors that they're going to are white, the clinicians that they see are white, the teachers that they see are white, if it's a person of color and all of their authority figures or a lot of them are white, that can also give a distorted image of the ability of people of color, their own people, to exercise authority, right? And for white folks to have positions of authority filled by people of color at their schools, in their sports teams, their extracurricular activities, whatever it is, allows them to actually have some connectivity to a person of color in a position of authority. That actually breaks down stereotypes, according to the research, as opposed to like the abstract, you know, successful person of color who maybe comes in to give a talk or maybe they see on TV. So it's about structuring things very deliberately, but we still have to come back to this kind of conversation on a regular basis. We have to have the conversation regularly. But the thing is, as long as you have it, as long as you're willing to confront stuff and challenge it, and what we also do is we talk very openly about discrimination, because when what the research says is for young whites in particular, if they grow up and you don't give them as a white parent the information about why we're so divided, they will fill in the blanks themselves. So if you grew up in a place like Philadelphia, for example, and you look around and you see the level of residential segregation and separation and isolation that exists between certain parts of Philadelphia and other parts of the mainline, as we head out of Philadelphia. And if you're a white kid growing up you know, in an area that's really overwhelmingly white, and yet you know who lives over there, and you know who lives mostly around you, and you know who you mostly go to school with. If you're 7 or 8 years old, how do you process that? Well, if I'm your parent and I tell you, look, one of the reasons for this level of separation is, you know, this stuff that's happened and continues to happen called discrimination. Let me tell you what that is. As long as I give you that context, you can get, you're not going to totally understand it, but okay, you'll get your head around it. If I don't give you that context, you're going to come up with your own 7-year-old answer. And what is the 7-year-old answer? The 7-year-old answer is one of two things. Either, well, that's just the way it is. It's natural. I guess they live over there, and we live over here, and we can't make anything of it, and there's no real reason for it. It's just, which is not a helpful conclusion, because it's not right. The second possibility is even worse. What is a 7-year-old? They're egocentric. A 7-8-year-old kid is thinking, my stuff is the best. My neighborhood is the best. My family is the best. My friends are the best. My school is the best. Right? Now, if you're 7 or 8 years old and you're a white kid in particular growing up with some advantage and you think that, you're going to conclude, well, the reason they're not over here is because they're not as good. Right? So you have to have that conversation. There's this experiment, if you ever have read, and if you haven't, I recommend it to everyone. This book called Nurture Shock. It came out a couple years ago. It was a bestseller for about a minute. Really good book. And I mean, really good book. And it's about parenting and all the stuff we get wrong. Not just about race, but about a lot of stuff. And it's very enlightening as a parent. But there's a section in there about race. And one of the examples they use in the book, as I recall it was in that book, was they talk about elementary school kids, white, who they gave two different groups of elementary school white children a lesson about the old Negro leagues in baseball, right? And what was interesting was, okay, so they had this book about the Negro baseball leagues. And what they did, they gave each group of white students the book, but with one group, they took out some pages. The pages they took out with the one group were the pages that explained why the Negro leagues were created, which was in response to discrimination. It wasn't just some random thing. Black folks were like, let's start a league, right? It was that they were being run out of and had been run out of in the 1880s and 1890s, professional baseball, so they created their own league. One group got the whole story. One group of white kids got the full story. They created this league as a response to oppression. The other group got the story about the league and some of the players and the names, but they didn't get the story about the reason, the oppression. Then what they did is, before they had the lesson, they had done a pretest, like a survey with these young children, 8-9-year-old kids, to try to test their levels of racial empathy for racial others, their levels of racial prejudice, the extent to which they bought into certain stereotypes. So they pretested them, they did the lesson, then they post-tested them for the same things, empathy and prejudice. With the group that got the story about discrimination, there was a significant decrease in prejudice toward black folks, and there was a significant increase in empathy, right? For the group that didn't get the context, that didn't find out why the Negro Leagues had existed, there was no increase in empathy, and there was no reduction in prejudice, right? So what does this say? It says if you give folks the full information, they'll oftentimes go in the right direction with it. It's that we withhold it. And according to that book, you know, black parents 3 times more likely than white parents to talk to their kids about race. 75% of white parents never talk to their children about race. So then the white kids grow up, and they're not, they don't have the context to interpret the social reality that they see. So if they see the prisons being filled with black and brown bodies, oh well. They see, you know, lower income housing looking like this, oh well. There's no context. And we can't just rely on the schools to do that. Hopefully they will do their part, but really the parents also have got to put some of that in perspective, and usually we just don't do it. So we have to be willing to do it. Even if we make mistakes, drop the ball, we got 18 years to pick the ball back up, and you know, 18 years to fix things when we screw them up with our kids. So we will screw some things up, and we will have to make some changes, but I think that conversation, having the hard conversation, is really, really important. And with white kids, one of the ways that I try to do that is I talk to my kids about, so that they won't feel helpless, because a lot of times, you know, little white kids learn about oppression of people of color, and you know, they can internalize guilt, they can internalize helplessness, they can assume that they don't have a role to play. So we talk about white allies. First off, they have one in the house, so they can see me by virtue of my behavior, but we talk about that historically. We talk about, you know, that there are white folks always who have stood up, not enough, but there have always been white folks in every generation who've stood up. And these are the role models that we have. These are the people that we talk about, you know, at least the white role models, and they're also role models of color. I mean, our girls, you know, had a baby doll, little plastic baby doll when they were 2 that they used to do, a black baby doll that they called Jesus. We were like, cool, that's fine. You know, that's like, we didn't try to correct them. They were like, yeah, that's Jesus. Oh, yeah, that's Jesus right there. And they, you know, to this day now, they sort of know that now. But actually, the story I'll tell tonight will show you that even when you start with that, and that was when they were little, we've had to deal with this whole conversation about religious imagery and about God and about, you know, because this stuff, after a while, you get conditioned to go back to old ways. So you always have to come back to to the conversation. And you just have to be willing to have the conversation. And the research on folks of color says, just so we know that, you also have to be careful, because when parents of color are having the conversation with their kids about oppression, if they're 6 and 7 and 8 years old, 10 years old, 5 years old, that can be scary. Like, if you're telling an 8-year-old black child or 8-year-old Latino child about the history of what's been done to black people in this country and around the world, you can imagine, like, an 8-year-old black child, the first thing that kid's going to think is, oh my God, is that going to happen to me? That's the totally logical thing for that child to think. So that scares a kid. So how do you do that? Well, the way that we talk about it, and I train teachers to do this, and I talk to parents about it, is you can teach that material. You don't have to pull punches. You don't have to, you don't soft pedal it. But what you do is you make sure that whenever you're talking about oppression, you're talking about it through the lens of resistance. Right? It's always about, in other words, it's not this was done to our people. It's this is what our people did in response to the things that were done to us. So now I'm starting with a whole different frame. If I'm a black parent, a Latino parent, an Asian parent, a Native American parent, and I'm starting with the resistance story, I'm saying not just that we were some passive victims and targets. This is how we responded, whether it was slave rebellions, whether it's the civil rights movement, whether it's whatever, you know, resistance on the part of indigenous people. That has a whole different impact, because if I'm a child of color and I hear that, I realize I'm not an object of history, I'm a subject of history, right? That I have choices to make, that I have agency, that I can intervene on my own behalf in my life. I don't have to be a sort of willing participant in this. And the white narrative is the ally narrative. And if we do the ally narrative and the resistance narrative together, particularly in schools, then everybody can sort of see that they have choices. And that there's no passivity here, there's no time for passivity. That folks of color have to resist as they always have, that white folks need to act in solidarity as we sometimes have. And then we can break through some of the guilt and also the internalized peace. You know? So that's it. Thank you all so much.